Caesar. Buy the world a token. Teach the
copyright
world to sing. Perfect harmony and teach the world.
Can't have that. Sorry. Let's go to PowerPoint. Fortunately, most lo-fi stuff is so simple that nobody bothers to actually copyright it. Alright, how do I go to, like, next slide? Oh, okay, cool. Double check that I'm actually streaming this. And I know that I have my microphone on. That's totally fine. Intro to Animatronics Dry Run on Patreon. Yep, looks like that's working. Alright. Just give me 2 minutes to catch my breath. And we'll be getting into it. I'm not gonna have this music playing the whole time, by the way. Hopefully my audio is coming through okay. My lavalier microphone unfortunately decided to break the clasp off of itself as I was putting it on, so I'm gonna be using the blue snowball today. So just consider this a little bit of an audio test, what I'm doing right now. We're gonna start at 1:30 and then try to keep this to about 1 hour, because that's all the time that I'm gonna have for the actual convention. And if I go over, that's fine, because I know that I've definitely got a lot of material that I could potentially cover. And this is gonna be available for anybody after the convention that didn't get to make it to the panel that still wants to learn about animatronics. I just wanted to, you know, make that available for people, just in case somebody didn't get to go. So, excuse me. Alright, looks like we're at 1:30, so let's go ahead and get started. I'm gonna mute the music and pull up my PowerPoint. Just desktop? No, let's go. Yeah, there we go. And I also want the webcam on me as well. What happens when I go in present mode? Oh, okay. I guess that's fine. We'll have a little camera view on me right now so that you can see my magnificent lab coat with all of your wonderful signatures on it. Thank you, patrons, for helping support what I do. So, animatronics. Today we're going to talk about animatronics. What the heck are they? When you think about animatronics, you probably are imagining those crazy, complicated machines underneath the faces in Hollywood special effects animal robots, or like the humanoid creatures that are the Na'vi from the, am I blanking on the name? Pandora, the Avatar movies. There we go. But animatronics don't have to be all that complicated, actually. And that's good, because if you try to jump straight into that, it becomes overwhelming really, really quickly. Animatronics are basically anything that uses an arbitrary and uninteresting source of motion to generate a more sophisticated and complicated one. So, a source of motion could be the movement of your elbow, It could be your knee. It could be the arching of your back, the shrugging of your shoulders. I've seen people make robotic tails that just use your shoulder movement to pull cables and move them, which we'll talk about animatronic tails. And then, of course, there's, you know, motors. So we have something that rotates, something that moves forward and backward. Basically, the only two types of motors out there. And we're going to take that motion, apply a little bit of cleverness and imagination, and turn it into something that that does what we want, whether it be blinking an eye or moving an ear or... I don't know, maybe something more complex, maybe like an entire robotic hand or something like that. I don't know, foreshadowing maybe, we'll see. when I get started in any kind of project that I'm working on, I typically break it down into like a game plan of three basic steps where I research and plan out what I'm going to do on paper first, with an idea in my mind, trying to figure out what is out there already that works similarly to what I want to try to make. Then I try to build a basic prototype as fast as possible, sometimes out of cardboard, plastic, whatever I have on hand. 3D printing has become a huge part of my workflow, so expect to see some of that. And then I later on integrate the electronics. So adding motors, sensors, and programming is typically the last step for me because starting with that doesn't really make much sense for most things that I do. A lot of times I don't even need to get to the electronics part, so we're going to cover that last. So any kind of animatronic out there that you'll come across boils down to basically these four sets of four bar linkages. And it's a really good place to start if you're trying to get into animatronics, because you can do all kinds of four-bar linkage design in just two dimensions, and you can do that for free in Fusion 360, there's like other link design programs that you can use for free, or you can even just draw them out on pencil and paper to try to get an idea of what's going to happen. Basically, we have, let's see if I can animate these. We're basically using linkages to transmit motion from one place to another. We are doing parallel linkages, inverting linkages if you want to invert the motion from one place to another. You can, see if I can skip, there we go. You can amplify the amount of movement going from one place to another by connecting a linkage to a closer point on closer to the point of rotation, or you can reduce the amount of motion by doing the same thing in reverse. Now, of course, this doesn't look like much, but let's see some application. One of the first applications is just using somebody's jaw motion to provide the input for these four bar linkages. In this case, the jaw motion is amplifying the motion of a beak in this example. On the bottom set there, we have a motion amplifying linkage, making it look like the bottom jaw is opening far, far wider than the person's head inside of the costume. And then the top set of linkages there is actually inverting the motion of the jaw so that the beak opens upwards as well. And this is just a really, you know, fun, simple example. I tried not to make this too complicated, and that's going to be a running theme here. But very similar linkage arrangements were actually used by Willow Creative, who many of you may follow on Twitter, for her amazing werewolf mask. And she actually went the extra mile there and used some of that same motion from her jaw and connected a series of cables to run up to the ears so that the cables go back when she opens her mouth as well, actually. So just using that cleverness to apply to transmit motion from one place to another. That's really all that animatronics it boils down to. Another good example, perhaps one of the more picturesque versions, is a traditional eye and blinking mechanism that's transmitting motion from two servos using a coupled parallel linkage and an inversion linkage to drive the blink mechanism, and an inverting linkage to drive the eye moving left and right. And this is designed to be very simple. There's definitely a lot more you can do with these kinds of motions. Will Cogley is a really good YouTuber to check out if you want to see some much more sophisticated eye blinking mechanisms. He's also got a robotic mouth that you should definitely check out, and some robotic hands that he's been working on for a while. So let's take a look at an example of not just individual sets of linkages, but linkages connected to other linkages. If we take a close look at this wing mechanism, you can see that in the blue we have the input that is first driving this set of four. Wonder if I can make my pen a laser pointer. There we go. You can see this set of four bar links right here. That's doing basically a reduction. So it's actually reducing the amount of motion. And then that's driving another linkage that is the input for this other set of four bar linkages. One, two, three, four. So this is sort of a compound linkage set, and by cleverly combining these different linkages, you can generate more sophisticated and interesting types of motion, like opening and closing a bird wing, for example. Or one of the more common compound linkages you may be familiar with is the boxing glove on a spring thing, where you have this crazy accordion of links that shoots a boxing glove out really, really far. So just amplifying the motion from one motion amplifier to another, to another, to another, to another, till you have this really, really long chain of amplified motion. One good example of another type of compound linkage is in a finger joint mechanism. So this is an old project where I made a set of robotic hands that every finger was driven by an individual servo, and I amplified the motion coming out of that servo using compound amplification of multiple linkages connected to other linkages, and that gives you this really cool robotic motion. So So where do we go with this here? Or I guess you could really go anywhere with it. It's sort of up to you what your application is. But yeah, starting with four bar linkages is a really good place to start. All of these fingers were actually designed in two dimensions first, which made it really, really easy. I think from starting on it to the initial prototype only took about 2 months. And I'd say only about a week of that was design work. So, yeah, you can really do just about anything with four bar linkages. Now getting into things that are perhaps a little bit more complicated. Let's say we needed a four-bar linkage that isn't in two dimensions, but is actually in three dimensions. Well, there are tools for that, and one of those is called a Heim joint. And basically, you can connect a motion source and a motion output with what's called a push-pull rod, which is basically just a rod with a Heim joint on either end of it. It's just a spherical joint, so it can rotate in any direction and transmit motion from one place to another, even if those aren't necessarily in the same plane. I used these on my complex pneumatic stilts to transmit motion from the ankle to the toe, because I couldn't exactly go in a straight line there, and I couldn't do it with cable pullers either, which we'll get into. And one neat thing that I'll mention about push-pull rods is that if you have them threaded in opposite directions, you can actually create an adjustable length push-pull rod. So that's good for if you're like me and you don't really plan things all the way through before you get started. Anyway, that's me demonstrating that down there. So as I twist this linkage, you can see the toe start to move right here. So let's see what's on the next slide here, because I kind of forgot. Oh yeah, cable pullers. Another instance of where you may need to transmit motion from one place to another that's not necessarily in a straight line is if you are making some kind of cable puller mechanism, right? Where the whole thing is flexing. Like in the case of a robotic tail that responds to your acceleration and rotation, as well as potentially muscle signals. Or if you're trying to make robotic fingers, tentacles, maybe you're making snakes for a Medusa cosplay of some sort, you can use cable pullers to do that. So what is a cable puller mechanism? Basically, it's a length-dependent device. So rather than force-dependent like linkages, it is a length-dependent device where if you pull on one set of cables, it tries to shorten the length of the assembly in one direction. And the only way that it can do that is by actually flexing towards the direction that you're putting tension on the cables. You can also start with something that is curled inwards, such as this closed bias animatronic finger, and then you can pull that to make it open. So you can really go any direction you want with it. The one rule, though, of cable puller mechanisms is that if something is going to be in tension, something else has to be in compression. So in this example, right now my string that runs through the finger, that is obviously in tension. So if the rule is true, something must be in compression. What is in compression? Well, that would be my fingers, actually. My fingers there, holding onto the base of it, are reacting the exact same amount of tension, but in the opposite direction. So as I pull on it with some amount of force, my fingers react the same amount of force the opposite direction. It's just Newton's laws. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. And when it comes to transmitting motion from one place to another without, I'd say, without any kind of rigid linkages, cable pullers also end up being very useful for that as well, through the use of something called a Bowden tube. And like I mentioned earlier, something must be in compression. Well, that's what the Bowden tube is actually for. If you've ever scratched your head at how the cable actuators on your bicycle work the brakes, you're basically just pulling a cable through that tube. But the tube itself is doing something really important there, because if the tube wasn't there, then you would have to pull directly on the brake pedal line. It would be a straight line from your handle down to the brake pedal. In fact, a lot of early aircrafts actually are like that. For the control mechanisms that they use. So the Bowden tube there is not just guiding the cable, but it's also reacting all of the compression. So you can see by my little cutaway illustration here that if I put tension from one place to another along the course of this Bowden tube, the Bowden tube is all acting in compression infinitesimally across the entire surface of it. And these become instrumental if you're ever trying to make something that has delocalized movement. So let's say I wanted to make something that, I don't know, twitched an ear whenever I moved my elbow. Well, I would have to use some kind of tension transmission Bowden tube there to make that possible. This also comes in handy for robotic tails, because you need a way, if you have multiple independent sections that are controlled, so like let's say I wanted to pull on just the tip of the tail and make that move versus pull on the body of the tail and make that move independently, well, I need to have that motion isolated to those specific areas. So for my robo-tail, I used Bowden tubes inside the tail that run close to the core to bypass the tension for the tip of the tail through the center core of the main body of the tail. Hopefully that makes sense. One thing that I wish I had known about before I started on my robo-tail project is how to actually put these tubes together. The first thing that I tried was rubber tubing. It was like a urethane rubber of some sort. And because the tube itself has to be in compression, what would happen every time I pulled on the cable is that the tube would actually shorten. So I was losing some of the efficiency of my string pulling to actually squishing the tube down to a shorter length. And if you want to try to get around that, the best thing to do is to use a hard, stiff tube that has just a little bit of, you know, bendiness to it, but isn't able to compress. And one of the best materials for that is Teflon, not only because it's fairly stiff and difficult to compress, but also because it's fairly slippery as well. And if you use a nylon-coated wire inside that Teflon tube, your friction goes pretty much to zero. So but the thing is, with Teflon, it's very difficult to glue into places unless you use a very specific type of adhesive. And this Loctite bonding system actually works fairly well, but really the better options are to go with a mechanical connection. So you're either using a push-to-connect air fitting, a lot of 3D printers use this, or you can actually flare the tubing, as I found, by heating it up with a flame. And you slip it through a hole first, flare it out so that it's too big to slip back through the other way, and then you can hold the tube in place without ever worrying about it coming loose, because it physically cannot slip through that hole. Okay, so we talked about pulling on cables using human motion, such as like an elbow or a knee, or shrugging your shoulders to move, to transmit tension from one place to another. But one thing that I want to mention is servos, because a lot of people start out with servos. I actually highly recommend starting out with servos because they're very, very simple. And one thing I see a lot of people do actually when they start out with servos is that they connect the cable puller directly to this servo arm that comes in the package. But the problem with that is the maximum amount of pole length you're going to get is dependent on the length of the arm. You're only going to be able to pull it 2 times the radius of the arm itself. That may be okay if you don't need to pull a whole lot, but if you lengthen the arm, you're actually cutting down on the total amount of force you can provide, because if you have a finite amount of torque coming from your servo, then to keep the torque the same using the torque equals force times distance equation, your force is going to go down if your distance goes up, and your distance is going to go down if your force goes up. But one way to circumvent this problem is to fix a pulley onto the servo instead and use something called a sail winch servo, or a continuous rotation servo, or something else that spins continuously. And that way, you can have a very, very short moment arm on your servo so that you get the maximum amount of force out of it without diminishing the amount of distance you can actually pull the cable. And that's something that I've used in my Robotail pretty much since the beginning. It was very early on that I figured this out. I really recommend everybody try it because you can make very, very compact motor assemblies using this method. Speaking of building things, the next thing after researching how the next thing to do after researching how mechanisms work and what you're trying to build and trying to get a little bit of a head start on designing them is just try to build something early on that just works. When I was working on a project for Casa Bonita, I built cardboard prototypes of a bottle dispenser that I was designing for them, and went through like three or four iterations of that really, really quickly without having to spend any actual money, and that's always good. And then if you've got a bunch of plastic tubes laying around, I found that if you have a Dremel and a heat gun, you can pretty much build anything out of them. Back in high school, I actually built this entire suit of armor on a budget of $100 with only ABS plastic drainage pipes. I'm thoroughly convinced that a Dremel is like the best tool to start with if you're new to like just making things in general, because you get so much bang for your buck out of them. And then if you need like a router, well, hey, there's a router attachment. If you need a drill press, hey, there's a drill press attachment for your Dremel. I highly recommend them, and thank you, Dremel, for sponsoring this. No, I'm just kidding. They did not actually sponsor anything. So the other thing I would recommend is you're probably going to need to learn some sort of CAD program. I started out using Autodesk AutoCAD, which is actually a structural design software that's not made for doing 3D modeling, but my first two or three Robotails were designed using an architectural design software, and it was way harder than it needed to be. If I had known that I could get access to Fusion 360 for free back when I started, I definitely would have jumped on that train as soon as humanly possible. This is a puzzle box assembly that was done in Fusion 360. It really is like a full-featured CAD software that you can actually get for free for personal use. And you can export 3D print files with it. You can actually do CNC files with it. And you can do these cool complex mechanical assemblies to test out your design before you actually go and build it, which saves you a whole lot of time and materials in the future. The other thing that's really nice about Fusion 360 is that you can import real-world models from McMaster, which is actually integrated into the software, so that you can make sure these real components are going to fit into your model, because sometimes you need real-world components. You need shafts, bushings, maybe you need motors and circuit boards and things in there. Well, McMaster Car allows you to download all of these 3D models for free of all the components that they sell. Well, almost all of them, actually. So when I discovered that, it was like getting a superpower, because I could just go on McMaster, search for the component that I needed, and then drop them into Fusion 360 like puzzle pieces and start putting things together. It's really, really cool. McMaster isn't the cheapest option for gathering raw materials by any standard or stretch of the imagination, but it's definitely a really good catalog to like know what's out there. It's basically just an all online hardware store that just has everything you could possibly imagine and some things you couldn't imagine. But anyway, moving on. 3D printing was definitely a massive step forward for me when I started working on my robotic tail project. And it's been a part of just about every project that I've worked on since then. And when I started out, I was using a 3D printer that was the cheapest I could possibly find, which was like $300 in 2015. And it was a total piece of crap, but it did end up being worth it. I think now you can even get a decent 3D printer for like $200. But I just want to point out, because this is something I tried first, is if you can't find a 3D printer that fits your budget, you can actually 3D print for free at a lot of modern libraries. Or you can find a makerspace. So here I am at a makerspace with the co-founders of Diabase Engineering. They created a 3D printer that prints on a rod that rotates rather than a platform that moves around from side to side. Really, really smart dudes. And they did everything out of a makerspace. So really, there's a lot of powerful tools out there at your disposal without having to spend a lot of money. But I just wanted to mention that. Another quick note on assembly, because another thing that I've done and that I see people do when they first start putting things together, such as 4-bar linkages, is they'll tie linkages together using screws and nuts, and that basically just clamps them together so that they can't move. You either want to use a lock nut or you want to tap directly into the material and then lock it in place that way as well. If you are okay with a little bit of extra money on fancier fasteners, shoulder screws are fantastic because they have a smooth running surface and they provide their own clamping force, actually. So you can basically put these shoulder screws in and it's like an all-in-one axle and captured nut and everything, and they're very low profile. So shoulder screws exist. I just wanted to point that out. And also I wanted to point out, just stay away from Phillips head screws. I actually was planning on doing a panel which was just gonna be me ranting about Phillips head screws for an entire hour. I swear I have that much to rant about with Phillips head screws. They're designed to suck. Just trust me on that and instead use socket head cap screws or hex head cap screws. Whatever you can fit an Allen wrench into, that's the kind of screw that, in my opinion, is the best for animatronics because it makes assembly so, so much easier. A lot of times when you're putting screws in things, you want to tap holes into the material. But again, that's not necessarily necessary. It's kind of a weird way to say that. Because there are these things called heat inserts. So if you're 3D printing a whole bunch of stuff like I am, and you're trying to put screws in things, taking them apart, putting them back together, taking them apart, putting them back together. If you're doing that into raw plastic, eventually you're going to wear out the threads that you're making, and the screw is just going to strip right out. But if you use these things called heat inserts, you can just use a soldering iron to heat them up and push them into the plastic. And then the plastic melts around them, and then you have... fantastic, infinitely reusable threads. Looks very professional. And I think you can get a bag of 100 of these for like $5 or something. Like, they're very, very cheap. Just go on AliExpress and you get the best deal you could possibly imagine. That or like Geek or Wish.com or something like that. All right, so we moved on to the incorporating electronics portion. So let's talk a little bit about motors and actuators. The first one that I want to mention is linear actuators. And there's basically two different kinds. There's solenoid type linear actuators. I'm not going to talk about pneumatic actuators just as a heads up because that's a whole other animal. But solenoids are essentially electromagnets. So you apply a current one way, and it produces a magnetic field in a corresponding direction, and you can flip that and then go the other way. They are extraordinarily quiet. You may hear a little bit of a click while they're in operation. It just goes click, 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 back and forth, back and forth. And those are really good if you only need an intermittent motion, such as like a blinking for something. If part of your design is only going to move to one place or to another place, then push-pull solenoids are a really good option for that. And I kind of wish more people knew about them. Push-pull solenoids are also all over the place in like player instruments. So any kind of robotic instrument that plays itself, such as, you know, hitting the keys on a piano or a marimba or tapping a drum or something. Everybody uses solenoids for those because they work forever and they're very, very cheap. So you can get a whole bunch of them for very cheap. The other option, if you need something that moves linearly but also tracks its position continuously, that is a linear servo. These are actually quite expensive, but they are very, very strong, which push-pull solenoids are not. So I think in this finger demo, I tested this thing out, and this tiny little linear servo was able to lift like 15 pounds or something. And it was able to move in precise increments of like 0.1 millimeters. Although that servo there cost like $60. So I do not recommend them, and this is why I only made one finger version of this actuator design. Next, we get into continuous rotational motion. So if you need to spin a pulley around to try to lift some very, very heavy wings, then you probably want something that can turn multiple times. Or let's say you're trying to make like a drill that goes on the end of like a Big Daddy cosplay. A stepper motor would probably be a good way to do that. If you just go with a straight DC motor, typically those aren't going to be very strong. So they make these things called worm gear motors, or sometimes just gear motors, where they've taken a straight up DC motor and they've stuck a big old gear reduction train on the back of it, so that while this thing is spinning at like 1,000 RPMs, this is spinning at like 1 RPM or something. And what you get out of that is an extremely high torque. So I put these to use in a project where a cosplayer wanted to lift these big heavy wings up on a frame made out of an old bicycle. And it wasn't very well, let's just say that she was early on in her engineering career, and it took like 20 pounds of force to actually lift these wings because she had a really short moment arm. And so I incorporated these little motors into her design and used potentiometers to control the direction and the speed of each one so that she could lift them up, and it worked quite well. Stepper motors I haven't really used a whole lot, but you'll see them a lot in 3D printers because they're very precise. They can spin an infinite number of times, and they also, unlike gear motors, don't have any moving parts except for the spindle that runs through the center, which is connected to a set of magnets. And these just use magnetic fields that continuously change to rotate them around. But because of that, controlling them is actually very very sophisticated. I won't necessarily say difficult, because there's some people that would say, oh, stepper motors are easy, man. And I would look at you and say, you're crazy, because it took me like 2 weeks to figure out how to actually get some of these things to turn. There's all these different drivers you can get. Some of them are really, really quiet. Actually, I'd say stepper motors are probably, if you do it right, the quietest motors out there. So, and they come in a various range of sizes as well. So I think sometimes I think even like Disney right now for like the Navi, they were using like miniature stepper motors inside of the masks to move the facial expressions around. Well, they're not really masks. Those Navi animatronics are just filled with wires, and there's not really enough room to put a head in there. But anyway, these actually have no idea where they are, neither the worm gear motor nor the stepper motor. So if you want to actually track the position of them, which may be necessary to do, you can use something called an optical encoder, or what is it called? Well, there's different types of encoders out there, but they basically allow you to track the position of something rotating without stealing any of the actual force out of it. Now, finally, we have probably the holy grail of animatronics, at least for people that are starting in animatronics, and that would be the servo. And there's two different types of servos that I'll mention. Earlier, I mentioned linear servos. These are basically the same kind of idea. You tell it a position, and it goes to that position. Very, very simple. You can get the cheap 180-degree servos that... that make kind of a racket when you turn them on. So they're a little bit loud because they've got very loose tolerance gears that are injection molded inside of them. And then there's also the multi-turn sail winch servos that I also mentioned earlier that can turn like 6 times or maybe 9 times and still attract the position. They're actually extremely strong because most of them are based off of the like 25 gram servo form factor, which have metal gears inside. They're really solidly built. Subtle Metal Gear Solid reference. When you're working with motors, something I want to point out is that you're going to run into some problems where the motors try to break themselves or the motors try to break the electronics as well. So first we're going to talk about how to save your motors from breaking themselves. Your motor typically, let's see, how should I put this? Motors will draw an infinite amount of current when you first turn them on. Servos are very, very forgiving. So those actually have resistors built in to prevent that from happening. But it's always a good idea just to throw in some kind of way to stop that from happening, like a current limiting resistor or some kind of a power throttle transistor, like an NPN transistor, that you can use your programming to reduce the amount of power that goes into the motor. If your motor stalls out, it'll try to draw the maximum amount of current possible for as long as possible. Because servos are kind of dumb, they don't really know if they don't really know if they're hitting a wall or not. So you can also use a current sensor to measure the amount of current that is going into them in case you need to shut it off at any point. And now, so that's how you can protect your servos and motors electrically, by using some sort of power sensing technology. But you can also protect them mechanically as well. If you think about how a servo has a whole bunch of different gears inside of it, going from a really tiny motor that spins really fast to a small spindle that moves really slowly, if you try to back drive that and you try to apply a whole lot of force to it all at once, the amount of pressure that you're putting on the gear teeth inside can actually be so much that it snaps the gear teeth or even the spindles. So one thing that I always recommend doing is adding a little bit of compliance between where the motor is and the thing that it's moving, because then that way, if your assembly makes a sudden stop or it's a jerky motion, it's not causing a bunch of damage to the motor. And an easy way to think about this is it's not the motion or the force that causes damage to motors, it's a sudden stop. It's like, imagine you have a nail sticking out of a piece of wood, and now try to push that in with your thumb. Okay, You can't. Take a hammer, set it gently on top of the nail, and now try to push it in with your hand. Okay, you can't, but I'm using a hammer, so what gives? Well, if you take that same hammer, and then you just lightly drop it on the nail, it's the sudden stop that transfers the maximum amount of energy into the nail, which causes it to break through the wood fibers below. Same thing with motors. It's not the force, it's the sudden stop. So, we've talked about how to protect the motors. Now let's talk about how to protect your electronics from the motors. Because like I said earlier, at any given time, the motor will draw an infinite amount of current unless it's told not to do so, because all that's inside is just a bunch of copper windings typically. So you can use something called a current limiting resistor, which is basically just a really, really small value resistor. and I actually had to do this on my Robotail project later on, because what was happening was whenever the three or four motors would turn on at the same time, my circuit board would restart. And it was because it ran completely out of power to actually run the brains of the operation. So I just added a little bit of resistance in the form of a whole bunch of wires. And that seemed to have solved the problem. Because if we look at Ohm's law, voltage equals current times resistance, if the resistance is zero, the voltage will also be zero. So if you have any kind of resistance there at all, that actually is a good thing, and that helps you prevent your circuits from dying out. The other thing to remember is that when a motor switches from one direction to another, the magnetic field that is created by the windings inside has to change direction. And that directional change in the magnetic field will actually create a current in the opposite direction. So you can actually get a back current that can go to wrong places. You're basically forcing some flow upstream to parts of the electronics that shouldn't get that, because maybe you're going back through a diode that you're not supposed to. So something to be aware of. There's some fantastic explanations of why this is something to worry about, but not really worry too much about, on sharetechnote.com. Definitely check that out if you want to learn more about that. Next, we've talked about... Okay, so how do we control the motors themselves? Finally, we're getting into some actual programming and stuff. Depending on what kind of motor it is, you'll need various accoutrements to help make it move. For example, if you're using a worm gear motor, like I mentioned earlier, an H-bridge motor driver is a fantastic off-the-shelf solution that's very cheap that you can interface with an Arduino. If you're using a push-pull solenoid, typically those require quite a bit of current and quite a bit of voltage, much more than an Arduino itself can provide. So a relay block is the way to do that. It's basically just a mechanical switch controlled by a very small electromagnet inside that you can trigger on and off for a very small fee of like 5 volts. And they make a little bit of a clicking sound. I think sometimes you can find ones that are silent, but that's a good way to control push-pull solenoids. Stepper motors kind of have their own driver boards that you can find on the internet. Depending on what kind of stepper motor it is, you just have to do some research and see what sort of stepper motor driver you need. And the way that you wire this stepper motor driver is dependent on the driver itself, so I kind of have to throw my hands up at this one. It gets complicated. Servos are definitely the easiest to interface with, because you can just plug them directly into a microcontroller or an Arduino or a Raspberry Pi, whatever it is. If the servo runs off 5 volts, great. If the servo runs off of something like 10 volts or 12 volts or something like that. You'll have that on its own separate connection, but you'll still send it signals directly from the Arduino. There's no middleman, which makes it really, really nice to get started with servos. Now, I've mentioned Arduino a lot, but what the heck is an Arduino? Well, an Arduino is basically a miniature computer that's not very, very complicated. So they're actually extraordinarily easy to get started with. And one of the things that I think people that deters people from wanting to get started with in these kinds of projects is cost a lot of the times. Everything that I have up here on the screen, you can get for like $20 total. Yeah, for real. So the Elegoo Unos are a knockoff of an Arduino Uno, which you can get for like $8 on Amazon. You get that, some jumper wires, some breadboards, and a couple of cheap servos for just a few bucks. Download the free software for programming Arduinos, and then you can get started making simple animatronics projects right off the bat. And here's the thing with Arduino. I highly recommend starting with something that moves. Have a sensor and something that moves. Because that instantaneous feedback of you can see something moving and you can hear the motor turning on, and you can get instant feedback on how your programming changes are affecting the behavior of the physical thing in the real world, is so much more intuitive and helpful than like when I tried to learn HTML or like JavaScript, because it was like, okay, cool. Now the text box is a different size. Yay! But what is actually going on here? I don't know. So starting with motors is a really, really good idea, you know. And you can do it for really, really cheap. That's all I'm trying to say. I'm trying to get people to use Arduinos. They're really a whole lot of fun. And the moment that I started playing around with Arduinos, that was like a massive step forward in all of my animatronics projects. And if you need to get things even cheaper, then definitely check out wish.com. There's also an app called geekbywish.com, where for a while I was buying a new module like every week for like $3. And if you go and buy these on Amazon, they'd get delivered a whole lot faster, but they typically cost like four times as much. But yeah, you can just get an insane number of sensors off of wish.com for insanely low prices. I don't know how they're making money, but my guess is that they're probably like the Fast and Furious gang, and they're just like stealing truckloads of these things and then selling them on the black market. Let me look at all these sensors over here for like $21. That's, you know, I tried to build my own Arduino one time, and just trying to build my own Arduino out of raw materials cost more than $20. So yeah, you can definitely get into it for cheap. Don't let cost be a big fear factor for you. If you just, you know, set aside like $20, you can really go a long way, and then find out if you like it and if this is something that you would enjoy doing. And then as for sensors, there's a billion different types of sensors out there, so I'm not even going to try to list all of them. There's, you know, potentiometers, hygrometers, anemometers, thermometers, vibrometers, accelerometers, gyrometers, euromometers, any kind of ometer. But the way that you interface with them is all going to be a little bit different, but basically it goes like this. I find a sensor. I look up that sensor in Google. I find a great tutorial on Last Minute Engineers. Definitely check them out. That is a fantastic website for learning how to do things with Arduinos. I follow their wiring diagram. I run some example code, and I get some kind of variable output. Typically, you get numbers, and then you take those numbers and you plug them into variables that you already have in your code, like let's have the motor speed directly linked to the acceleration. And you just copy paste the acceleration variable from that example code and then drop it into the motor speed variable in your project code. And then bing, bang, boom, you got something that moves. And that's pretty much exactly what I did with like the 1,000 lines of code in my RoboTail program. It's basically just, how do I use this sensor? Okay, copy, paste, done. It's really, I feel like kind of a sham sometimes because of how little I really understand what's going on inside of the RoboTail. But I don't know, it's the thought that counts, I guess. Yeah, it's really, really not too scary. If you know how to work a Google, then you know how to do animatronics. And one thing that I wish I had known before I started was something called the map function that helps you do a lot of what I just talked about, where let's say I have a sensor that outputs a value from 0 to 1,000. Like the muscle sensors, for example, output a value from 0 to 1,000. And let's say my servo can be directed from degrees of 0 to 180. Well, the map function lets you directly replace those variables without having to do any math yourself, where you just say, okay, map 0 to 180 to 0 to 1000, and it scales everything for you. Yeah, Arduino, so easy. And then further on, let's say you do make some kind of a robot and you want to smooth it down, because one thing that servos do quite well is they move from one place to another at infinite speed. And sometimes that's not good because they can break themselves or they can break the project that you're working on. A couple of years ago watched a video, well, it was 1 year ago actually. Look at that. Yeah, it's right there. Well, a year ago, James Bruton, who I highly recommend following and watching on YouTube, put out a video on how to smooth the motion for animatronics. And it turned out that that all I needed to do was just copy-paste these two simple lines of code for every motion that I was trying to smooth out. And that was really all that it needed to do. So all that it's doing is, My RoboTail is saying move left or move right. There's a random chance to go from one place to another, and it sets a random distance from right to left that it needs to move. Now the position is created instantaneously, but the motors are only told to move to a small percentage of the final location that it needs to move to, and the code just loops like 1,000 times a second. And it smooths that stuff out so that your motion isn't super jerky and exaggerated, but it's actually much more lifelike and smooth. So definitely check out James Bruton. That's all I'm trying to say here, is that he's the real engineer, not me. Okay, so breadboards, right? We talked about breadboards. Breadboards are a really great way to play around with a bunch of things individually and try out a couple different circuits without having to dedicate yourself to one thing or another. You can use jumper wires to continuously rearrange and reconfigure the way things are wired up so that you can figure out how to use a sensor before integrating it into some kind of a circuit. But when it does come to integrating things into a circuit, I made the mistake of initially trying to make my own circuit board out of some copper-clad FR4 because I was following the first YouTube tutorial that I saw, and that was not a good idea. I actually spent way more money trying to make my own circuit board than if I had just learned a freaking CAD program for designing circuit boards and then sending them to JLC PCB. I use DipTrace because it only costs like $50 for a lifetime license, and for a extremely capable circuit design program, that is absolutely unbelievably cheap. And basically all you do is you take the exact same circuit that you used with a breadboard and you recreate that in the DipTrace design software. This is the RoboTail circuit board, just for example. And then you export the Gerber files after using the like auto circuit generation tools, because there's literally automatic circuit generation tools. Thank you, programmers. And then you send those Gerber files to a company called JLCPCB that'll manufacture like 10 of these for $2. I don't know how they do it for so cheap, man, because I tried to make these things myself and it cost me like $20 just to make one. So, yeah, definitely go check out JLCPCB. Thank you, JLCPCB, for sponsoring this. No, I'm just kidding. JLCPCB did not sponsor this. I tried. It did not work. They said no. The funny thing I just recently learned about JLCPCB is actually that they do CNC machining as well. So I recently got some bobbins made for my Robotail project, and had those CNC machined. Normally that's an extremely expensive thing to try to have done, but I think I only paid like $20 a piece for each of the parts that they sent me. So I'm in love with this company. I don't know what they do, and I don't want to know how they do it for so cheap. I'm okay with being blind and ignorant in this situation. But if you don't want to make your own circuit boards, proto boards are another option. If you're doing something simple, that can be a good way to go. Basically, it's just a board with a whole bunch of holes in it that you can solder whatever you want to. It can be a little bit messy, but sometimes you can make them look good if you really, really try. They're a nice temporary solution. It gets everything held down so that it doesn't break. Okay. Anyway, moving on. Wow, I'm just flying through this, and I think I am just about at the 1 hour mark here. So we are going to talk a little bit about electrical safety. First off, obviously I am not an expert and this is not legal advice. So if you do electrocute yourself, it's not my fault. Haha. Thank you, CYA. A good rule of thumb for protecting yourself from electricity, because eventually if you're making animatronics for costumes, which I'm sure a lot of you probably are looking at doing, is you're going to have some electronics on your body. And electricity and people don't often mix very well, because people are governed by little electrical signals. But one of the easiest ways to protect yourself is just to try to keep the voltage as low as possible. There's a lot of debate over whether it's voltage or whether it's current that kills you. It turns out it's a mixture of voltage, current, exposure, and frequency. So it's kind of complicated, I'll just say. But generally, if you keep things under 12 volts, you're probably fine. Although, do note that under the right conditions, you can shock yourself at just about any voltage. Like, your mouth is nice and wet and salty, kind of like the sweaty inside of a fursuit, or so, for example. Salt water is a very good conductor of electricity. Well, I won't say very good, but it's a good enough conductor of electricity that you could shock yourself with it. So if you ever need to run wires across your body, keep them insulated, keep the voltage low, and if you need to step up the voltage for any reason, do that in its own little confined space right before the device that actually uses it. My Magnificool cooling suit actually uses this concept inside of a little 3D printed housing. Because I need to step up from 12 volts to like 240 volts, and there's no way I want that anywhere near my body. Okay, now batteries, definitely make sure to mention this one. Never, ever, ever use those little bags of Chinese firework material. So the little the little aluminum foil, like lithium ion battery packs. I have seen like 5 of those explode in my lifetime, and it does not look like it'd be fun to have that on you. And unless you really, really know what you're doing, it's easy to get wrong and it's easy to make that happen. So I highly recommend sticking to the like trusted brands of hard shell battery packs with built-in charge and discharge protection. They often have nice fancy indicator lights, and they will prevent any kind of damage to the battery from overcharging, undercharging, or if you have some kind of short in your system, they'll just turn off rather than allow infinite current to flow through like one of these Chinese bags of firework material. And lastly, the wiring. The wires that do run across your body, try to keep them together so that you don't have a positive and a negative any like large distance apart that could create a large voltage differential. And then furthermore, you can wrap those in a nylon cable carrier insulation so that if something does break inside, that the wires cannot touch you. The least breakable wires are definitely stranded wires. Solid wire is much less bendy, and it will eventually snap and break if it gets bent too many times. So if it's going into a person's costume where they're going to be moving around a whole lot, stranded wire is definitely the way to go. Lastly, when you make junctions where you're going from some kind of a connector or like a plug or something out to a strand of wires. So like if you're doing an LED strip or something like that, the solder joints are definitely the most vulnerable part of your entire assembly. So the solder will actually eventually break. You can use lead solder. Actually is a bit stronger. That's something that I've learned from working in the aerospace industry for a while. We all use lead solder because it's far less likely to break. But you can further prevent that from happening by using heat shrink tubing and a little bit of hot glue or other potting material to help prevent that from happening. Oh, and then you can also look up tables for the wire gauges so that you're not putting too much current or too much voltage or the multiplication of the two through any kind of wire. And that's pretty much it. These are the auxiliary slides that, I don't really know what I was doing here, but, this has been an intro to animatronics, and, thank you so much for watching. If anybody did watch this live, sorry that I missed you if you had comments. If you do have questions later on, please feel free to hit me up on Twitter or on Instagram, on Patreon, wherever you happen to find me. My Telegram is at AtlasTheLion, all one word, if you want to send me a message on there and ask any questions about animatronics. So this has been an intro to animatronics, and I hope you enjoyed, maybe learned something, and I hope you go and do something really, really cool. All right, I think that went pretty well. Only went over by about 5 minutes or so. I feel like I had to rush a little bit there, but I did take a little bit of extra time at the beginning, and then at some points later on. I only have about 36 slides, so I definitely spent more than 1 minute per slide, and I think I can probably smooth this out a little bit if I try to, you know, tell fewer stories and just try to cut to the chase a little bit with each individual slide. But yeah, I think I'm going to end the stream here. I've got another PowerPoint to work on, actually. I thought I was going to have it finished today, and I might still be able to finish it later today. If I do, I'll do another live stream of me doing that. Let's go to the webcam here. So if I do finish that PowerPoint, I'll try to do another live stream of me running through that PowerPoint today. But until then, this has been Mechanical Magnificus. Thank you so much for watching, and continue to make life magnificent.